Today, I'll be talking about the basic concepts of AV block, in which there is a lack of normal electrical conduction from the atria to the ventricles through the AV node and His-Purkinje system. The learning objectives are to be able to recognize the common types of AV block and to know their etiologies. A classification system has been developed for the different forms of AV block that has proven helpful in identifying their etiology, prognosis, and guiding treatment. The first level of classification is called degrees. There are three of them. In first degree AV block, all atrial impulses are conducted to the ventricles, but with a longer than normal delay. In second degree block, only some atrial impulses are conducted. And in third degree block, no atrial impulses are conducted. If you are a little familiar with the topic of AV block, you may have also learned that there are two different types of second degree block. In practice, however, it's best to consider three different types of second degree block. Therefore, this gives us five overall forms of AV block. I'll review each one at a time. The simplest form is first degree block. As I said a moment ago, in first degree block, all atrial impulses are conducted to the ventricles, but with delay. Therefore, every P wave is followed by a QRS complex, but the PR interval is greater than the normal 200 milliseconds. Here's an example of first degree block. Notice the 1-to-1 correlation between P waves and QRS complexes. Every P wave gets conducted, and the PR interval is constant. However, that constant PR interval is prolonged. In this case, it's about 320 milliseconds. In second degree block, some but not all atrial impulses are conducted to the ventricles. Therefore, only some P waves are followed by a QRS complex. The three different types of second degree block are designated type 1, type 2, and the one which may be less familiar to you is referred to as 2-to-1 second degree block. Although I'm not a fan of this terminology because it adds an unnecessary eponym to nomenclature, the first two are occasionally referred to as Mobitz type 1 or Mobitz type 2. Use of the qualifier Mobitz is completely superfluous as there is no such thing as non-Mobitz type 1 or 2. Looking at type 1 first, which confusingly is also referred to by yet another eponym, Wenckebach block, in type 1 second degree block, the PR interval progressively lengthens until a P wave is not conducted. This non-conducted P wave is often said to be blocked. This pattern results in grouped beating, which is detectable on physical exam as a regularly irregular rhythm. So here's an example of type 1 block. The first thing you might notice is the repeating pattern of grouped beats. If you are feeling a patient's pulse or listening to the heart with a stethoscope, you would easily detect the patient's skipping beats. Next, look at the PR intervals. In the first complete cardiac cycle on the strip, the PR interval is about 280 milliseconds. For the next beat, it's about 380 milliseconds. And then we see a P wave that falls on the end of the T wave and is not subsequently followed by a QRS complex. This is a blocked P wave. In my experience, type 1 block is usually asymptomatic, but occasionally a patient may complain of palpitations, or very rarely, lightheadedness as a consequence of a resulting bradycardia. There's an interesting phenomenon that can happen with type 1 block, which will seem either confusing or even counterintuitive at first. The greatest change in the PR interval classically happens between the first and second conducted P waves in a group, and the change in interval gets smaller with each successive P wave. An unexpected consequence of this is that the RR interval may progressively shorten. Let me walk you through this so you can see how it works. So here's an example of type 1 block in which there are 5 conducted beats until one gets blocked. The initial PR interval at the beginning of the group is 150 milliseconds. The next PR interval is 200 milliseconds. The incremental increase in PR is thus 50 milliseconds. The next PR is then 225 milliseconds for an incremental increase of 25 milliseconds. Then the PR is 235 milliseconds for an increase of 10. Finally, the last PR interval is 240 for an increase of 5. The consequence of this decreasing incremental change is that the RR intervals will progressively shorten. So the first RR interval in the group is 715 milliseconds, the second RR interval is 690 milliseconds, then 675, and finally 670. This shortening of the RR interval is of too small magnitude to detect on exam, but may be measurable on EKG. Although it may seem of trivial importance, it can occasionally be helpful in distinguishing type 1 second degree block from block premature atrial contractions and more exotic rhythms. Note I used the word classically here. Although this is the classic Wenckebach pattern, exceptions to this are frequent, predominantly because the P2P interval is not constant most of the time, but varies with respiration. This can result in a changing RR interval that fails to adhere to any specific pattern or rule, with one exception. Almost always, the RR interval containing the blocked P wave is shorter than the sum of the two preceding RR intervals. This will also help to distinguish type 1 block from other superficially similar appearing rhythms. I don't want to stray too far from the topic of EKGs, but if you've ever questioned the value of the physical exam, consider that Dr. Wenckebach was a Dutch physician who first described this pattern of AV conduction before the invention of the modern EKG, solely by examining the waveforms of the venous pulsations in the neck while simultaneously feeling patients' pulses. Pretty phenomenal in my opinion. Although type 2 second degree block is more serious, it is far simpler to identify and understand. In type 2 block, the PR is constant and P waves are intermittently blocked, often at unpredictable intervals which can range from every third beat to only a handful an hour. Since the location of type 2 block is usually distal to the actual AV node and His bundle, most patients with type 2 block have a wide QRS complex. This location of the block is referred to by cardiologists as infrahissian, meaning distal to the His bundle, or in other words, within the bundle branches, fascicles, or Purkinje fibers. Here's an example of type 2 block. Notice that the PR interval is constant, easiest to see in lead 2 on the bottom. However, there are occasional P waves that don't get conducted. Before talking about the last type of second degree block, I want to briefly mention the concept of AV conduction ratio. When the pattern of second degree block is consistent, it is sometimes referred to by the ratio of P waves to QRS complexes. In the first example of type 1 block, there were 3 P waves for every 2 QRS complexes, thus this would be called 3-2 type 1 second degree AV block. And in the second example of type 1 block, there were 6 P waves for every 5 QRS complexes. This would be called 6-5 type 1 block. This brings us to the last type of second degree block, 2-1 block, in which every other P wave gets blocked. In this form, it is often not possible to tell where the level of block is. A narrow QRS complex in 2-1 block favors an intranodal location, that is, within the AV node itself, but this is not guaranteed. There are rare examples of 2-1 block with a narrow QRS complex which occur within the His bundle. Finally, is the most dangerous form of AV block, third degree. In this, no atrial impulses are conducted to the ventricles. Therefore, the P waves have no relationship to the QRS complexes, an example of something called AV dissociation. Third degree AV block is also called complete AV block, or most commonly, complete heart block. Here's a typical example of third degree AV block as seen in 2 simultaneously recorded leads. The P waves and QRS complexes are quickly identifiable, but if you look closely, there is no relationship between them. The regularly occurring P waves, whose frequency corresponds to both the sinus and atrial rates, are coming at 100 beats per minute. The regularly occurring QRS complexes, which are a result of a slow ventricular escape rhythm, are coming in at 37 beats per minute. The repeating patterns of blue and orange lines are superimposed on one another with no apparent influence on the other. It's important to realize that with no AV conduction occurring, that slow ventricular rhythm is the only thing keeping the patient alive. What is happening is a latent pacemaker focus within the ventricles, which is normally suppressed by a faster intrinsic supraventricular rhythm, takes over the pacing function of the heart when a supraventricular rhythm is no longer sensed. Unfortunately, these latent natural pacemakers within the heart are not reliable and can cease their pacemaker function without warning, leading to death. Although third-degree block results in AV dissociation, not all AV dissociation is a consequence of third-degree block, a point of frequent confusion among trainees. AV dissociation may also be produced by any situation in which the ventricular rate exceeds the atrial rate. For example, a severe sinus bradycardia or sinus arrest with a junctional or ventricular escape rhythm. Also, a significant percentage of ventricular tachycardia is characterized by AV dissociation. Some sources suggest that complete heart block cannot be diagnosed unless the ventricular rate is below some particular threshold rate. However, any chosen threshold is arbitrary. What's really key here is that in complete heart block, the P waves need to outnumber the QRS complexes, and the QRS complexes need to occur very regularly to suggest that no intermittent AV conduction is occurring or can occur. Here is just one example of AV dissociation caused by something other than complete heart block, in this case ventricular tachycardia, as seen in a simultaneous recording of all six limb leads. If you look really closely, you'll see that there are some inconsistently present variations in the appearance of either the T wave or the period just before the QRS complex. This is most noticeable here in the inferior leads of 2, 3, and AVF. These variations are due to the presence of P waves superimposed on the ventricular rhythm. In addition to the VT occurring at a rate of about 200 beats per minute, the patient appears to be having simultaneous sinus rhythm at about 86 beats per minute. Two different rhythms at two different rates for the atria and the ventricles. An example of dissociation which has nothing to do with AV block. In terms of the etiologies of AV block, there are many, and this long list is made more complicated because no one etiology can typically cause all forms of block. I think about the etiologies in four groups. The first group, which is the longest, contains the most dangerous causes and can result in either first degree, type 2 second degree, or third degree block. This includes idiopathic degeneration of the conduction system, which is actually the most common cause, ischemia or infarction, cardiomyopathy, infiltration of the myocardium around the conduction system, muscular dystrophy, myocarditis and endocarditis, which can be a particularly ominous sign, connective tissue disease, various forms of congenital heart disease, neonatal lupus syndrome seen in offspring from mothers with either lupus or Sjogren's syndrome, and as an iatrogenic complication from any one of a number of cardiac surgeries and other procedures. The second group of etiologies can typically cause either first degree, type 1 second degree, or third degree. This group includes medications, particularly beta blockers, calcium channel blockers, digoxin, and amiodarone. It also includes situations of high vagal tone, as seen in athletes, or in states of extreme visceral sensory input, such as peritonitis. The next two categories include physiologic causes of AV block rather than pathologic ones. Extreme tachycardia leads to type 1 second degree block in just about all people, provided that the tachycardia is fast enough. How fast depends upon many factors. Some people will develop it at atrial rates of 170 or 180, while in others it may take atrial rates of 250 or more. Obviously, rates this fast are rarely the consequence of sinus rhythm and are instead seen in atrial tachycardia and atrial flutter. Cardiologists may determine this threshold rate during an EP study by artificially pacing the atria at faster and faster rates until AV block develops. Finally, there is a normal variant in which a completely healthy patient may have mild first-degree AV block. It's estimated that 1 to 2% of healthy adults have a PR interval in excess of 200 milliseconds. Most of these patients will never progress to more serious conduction problems, and the chance that they will eventually need a pacemaker for some reason may be no different than those patients whose PR interval falls below the so-called normal cutoff of 200. As you might expect, however, the longer the PR interval, the more likely a serious occult disease could be present and that the patient is actually not completely healthy. But for the most part, PR intervals in the 200 to 240 range, in the absence of other findings suggestive of heart disease, are of no clinical consequence. I'll end this video with this summary, along with a brief mention of the prognosis and treatment for each form of block. In first-degree block, in which every P wave is conducted with a prolonged PR interval, the QRS can be either normal or wide, with a wide QRS suggestive of underlying block in the distal conduction system and unrelated to the AV block. First-degree block is benign, except under highly unusual circumstances such as a new first-degree block that develops during bacterial endocarditis, which can herald the development of myocardial abscess requiring emergent surgery. Second-degree block, type 1, in which the PR interval progressively lengthens until a P wave is blocked, also may be associated with either a normal or wide QRS complex, which usually is unrelated to the AV block. Type 1 block is usually benign, but may progress to third-degree block. A pacemaker may be indicated if the etiology is not reversible and if the patient is symptomatic. Type 2 block is usually associated with a wide QRS, consistent with the level of block usually being distal to the His bundle. Type 2 block is potentially life-threatening, with a high risk of progressing to third-degree block. A permanent pacemaker is usually indicated if the etiology is not quickly reversible. 2-to-1 block, associated with a normal QRS width, strongly suggests an intranodal location of block, whereas a prolonged QRS width can be consistent with any location of block. The prognosis and treatment depends upon the level of block. An intranodal 2-to-1 block behaves more like a type 1 block, whereas an infrahissian 2-to-1 block behaves more like a type 2 block. Finally, with third-degree block, a normal QRS width suggests that the escape rhythm is originating from the AV node or His bundle. A wide QRS suggests the escape rhythm is from the ventricles. Third-degree block is life-threatening, and unless the etiology is immediately reversible, pacemaker is necessary. The urgency of pacemaker placement depends upon the presence of symptoms, the width of the QRS complex, and the ventricular escape rate.